Bush Radio, the Deep Insight Radio.
Daganan kilo kilo bedening kom lo mohom.
Lo 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 lo.
Di beta maso sanalom.
Lo 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 lo.
Muasa benge kaputo.
State Affairs.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo. State Affairs with Edmund Obilo is live.
Welcome back, Segun Adeniyi on State Affairs. Look at what Chidi Amuta wrote about you. He wrote the foreword to the book. He said, Adeniyi, whose journalistic and writing career I have followed keenly and closely over the years, has an unusual historical consciousness that is foregrounded in the intricacies of Nigeria's troublesome political culture. Is that who you are?
I'm a reporter. Simple. And a reporter should have for news. I'm a reporter who likes to get the background of stories.
Is the Nigerian political system a troublesome one?
Is it not?
In the process of documenting the important milestones and development, Segun Adeniyi has gradually emerged as arguably the foremost and most credible chronicler of Nigeria's contemporary political history and evolution. That's a big one. What do you think?
It's very generous with words.
Very generous. What do you think you've achieved enough?
No.
You've achieved more than enough.
No, I haven't.
You've done so well. Haven't
you?
You say so.
If you say so, I claim it.
You claim it.
But I like to report. I like to report. And when I see big stories, I like to go to dig more. Like, for instance, I'm working on a book now, which should be out by July. That's From Frying Pan to Fire on Regular Migration. You see, it's going to be, I know it's a good book. So it's but it took efforts, because it's a book I've been working on for the last 3 years. I had to speak to people, I had to travel. But at the end of the day, I believe I will have something.
You're going to cover what is going on in the Mediterranean?
Yes, because I spoke to IOM people. I went to Spain, I went to Italy. I've been to several countries on it. The only country I want to go before the book is out is Libya. And maybe Mali. And hopefully I will go within the next 2-3 weeks.
Did you lampoon Nigerian authorities in the book?
No. I want to reflect the human tragedy and what's pushing people.
Why do you run away from... very strong critique of the system.
I do. I criticize the system. But it's not... what I'm saying is that the essence of the book is not about lampooning the system. It's about telling a compelling story so that we can take action.
Do we always take action?
We don't. Which is tragic. But I mean, we need to make all these efforts. But at the end of the day, changes are made.
Can a special advisor on media... contribute to governance?
How?
As a special advisor on media, did you contribute to governance?
Sure. I attended practically all the meetings of the president. So, I mean, in terms of policy, in terms of decisions, I was there. I mean, of course, I was the first spokesman to be a special advisor, which made me an official of cabinet level. So I attended meetings and I made contributions. I wasn't just attending for attending's sake. I made my inputs into every meeting.
Did they listen to you?
Of course they listened to me.
Did they implement your ideas?
No, I mean, when you go to meetings, you don't go with any preconceived notions. You go there to make your contributions. At the end of the day, your ideas might be accepted it might not be. There could be superior ideas. So, I mean, you win some, you lose some. That's what happens in such situations.
Did you win some?
Oh, sure. There were moments I felt very happy because I told myself, if I was not there, this discussion would not go this way. So, in those moments, you feel happy. But there were also moments where your contributions made no difference. So that's why I said, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose.
How come you were in the dark at the time Yaradwa was receiving treatment in Saudi Arabia?
I wasn't in the dark. Everybody knew he was receiving treatment.
You didn't get the real details in your book. You could not even release certain statements because you were not sure of what was going on.
I mean, nobody was sure of what was going on except those people who were there with them.
How come they skimmed you out?
No, they didn't skim you out.
They didn't?
No. I didn't. I mean, when I traveled with him to practically everywhere. Mm. But when it comes to the issue of Earth, when they were going to that for the Earth something, even if I had gone, I would have regretted going. Because I knew what transpired. Even the people that went didn't see the man. So he said, I would just have been marooned in Saudi Arabia. I thank God that I wasn't taken on that trip.
Was it that you were not close to Turaya Adua, the reason you were somehow skimmed out?
I wasn't skimmed out. I wasn't supposed to go for the... It was for a medical expedition. I was supposed to stay around in Nigeria. So on that trip, it wasn't a matter of skimming me out. It was even strategic that I stayed behind.
Even when you stayed behind, releasing statements were not easy for you.
I didn't release statements because I didn't know what was going on.
Ah, the special advisor on media...
Yeah.
Didn't know what was going on.
Unfortunately, that was what happened.
Should I say sorry?
Maybe I deserve it.
And when he came back to the country, it wasn't easy for you to see him immediately.
Yeah.
And when you saw him, how did you feel?
I felt sad. I cried.
Hmm.
I was the one who dismissed myself because, I mean, I cried with what I saw.
Yaradwa was a good man?
He was very good. I mean, very good to me. I had very good relationship with him.
Do you have a good relationship with Turai now?
I don't.
How come you didn't even want to have anything to do with her when you got to the presidency?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I learned is it's always tricky working with your boss's wife. So I learned a lot I tried to avoid her. I mean, I didn't want to get sucked into all this mommy thing.
Mm.
So I wanted to be professional. At the same time, offer her the kind of respect she deserved as the wife of my boss. But I wasn't close to her.
And you regretted that?
I regretted it I regretted it that maybe at the time when my boss was sick, especially when they came back, she was the only one who knew what was going on. Maybe if I had that close relationship with her, I'll be able to offer advice then. Well, I wasn't in a position to offer her any advice because we are not close.
This is you talking to media advisors to governors, yeah, saying studying your boss as well as those around him can make your job as spokesman easier.
Yeah.
It is one of the ingredients to make one succeed.
Yeah.
I was a spokesman to a man who did not like to talk about his health, and that was a major challenge. But looking back, I believe I made a strategic miscalculation.
Because if I was close to his wife, because he and the wife were very close, and the wife helped her. If I was close to the wife, I would be able to advise her. That's the regret I had. But I mean, I never foresaw the health issue. When I was going to government, that was the last thing on my mind. So I never imagined I was going to go through that kind of crisis. I mean, I was preparing to be spokesman to the president, how we handle policy and all that. Health, it was not one of my considerations. But it turned out to be the major thing. So, and I didn't know how to handle it. Maybe, looking back on reflection, I was saying that maybe if I was close to the wife, I would be in a position to advise the wife, especially in those during those dark days, because she was the only one who could have taken any rational decision.
After you, we later heard Ruben Abati.
Yeah.
He talked about spirits in Asurok.
And I can't tell him. Because I told him that I don't know about any spirit. I didn't see one.
Was it that the spirits came after you left?
Maybe. People die, people get sick and all those kind of, but to impute spirit and all that is I don't believe in that superstition.
But can't you see the coincidence? Stella went under Obasanjo.
Yeah.
Yara Adua under Yara Adua. Mrs. Jonathan almost went.
People get sick anywhere. People die anywhere.
And Buhari, not too long ago.
Buhari, maybe if you believe the superstition, I don't.
But tell me, what is Aso Rock like? I don't mean the structure. What is the feeling like in Aso Rock? Because sometimes you wonder why good things don't usually come out from Aso Rock.
I don't know. I mean, because for me, Aso Rock was no big deal by the time I arrived at State. Because I was a State House correspondent.
Yes.
Under Abacha, under IBB, under Abacha, and under Asunekan, the brief period. So I had reported State House before. So going back, there was no aura of what State House was like, because I was reporting State House under the same office. I mean, I was relating with spokesmen at the period.
What is the pressure like in Aso Rock?
The pressure is like, I've been editor before. I mean, when you talk about pressure, I don't know any pressure that was beyond being editor of ThisDay. Because it was a pressure cooker. If you edit a national newspaper, especially at the time I did, which is not as easy as it is today because of internet and other. So the pressure will not be any big pressure. The pressure of the work in Aso Rock was not bigger for me than the pressure I faced as editor of ThisDay.
Do presidents feel immense pressure?
No, they do.
Living in Aso Rock?
It's not about living in Aso Rock. It's about the challenge of the office. I believe that maybe if my boss had not been president, he probably would have lived more years than he did. Because the pressure of the office, I mean, the challenges, the what you have to contend with on a daily basis, if you really want to do your job, if you really care for the people, that alone can kill. I mean, that alone can take away years.
You don't mean it.
Yeah, I mean, I remember, I feel happier now than those 3 years I spent in Aso Rock, having to worry every day. The pressure, I mean, if you really care about service, it's not something that that's why I when people want to spend 10 years in, you wonder what are they going to do there? Do they really care? If they do, I mean, it's not something that you want to do for maybe 4, maybe at most 8 years.
If given the opportunity again to go back.
No, I'm not going back to government. What else will I be in government? I mean, as a journalist, the highest office any journalist can aspire to, a spokesman to the president.
You know, some feel that office, spokesman to the president, has been ridiculed by the kind of statements that come out from media advisors. Recently, we got a statement from the Buhari team saying that rodents invaded the office of the president. Can that be possible?
I don't know what they saw that made them to write that statement. I can't judge because I wasn't there. I didn't see the rodents. So I can't.
But can rodents invade the office of the president? That's an office you went into many times.
So I don't know. I don't want to speculate.
Is it that that position makes good journalists sometimes ridiculous with the kind of statement they release?
I can't speak for other people, but I can speak for myself.
Because while reading one of your books, you could see there were pressures on you sometimes to release statements that you didn't believe in.
And I will not. I mean, I will not release. And you know, most of these so-called ridiculous statements, I don't think anybody is putting anybody under any pressure to issue that kind of. People just go out of their way to just because they want to see something, and they end up saying something that happens to be ridiculous. That's the way I see it. It's not as if they are put under any pressure. Nobody puts any spokesman under any pressure.
You delivered a paper in 2014 entitled Between Faith and Fanatism in Nigeria. The paper was delivered in Lagos at the 4th Muslim Public Affairs Center National Convention. In the paper, you said we live in an age when people have built God in their own images, and that is the source of the problem we have in the world today.
Look at the issue of terrorism. what let's even look at it, let's localize it. What Boko Haram people, what are they killing for? They are killing, I mean, as far as they are concerned, they are killing for God. It cannot be the God that you and I serve. I mean, it's as simple as that.
In that same lecture, you said with Boko Haram, for instance, there were rationalizations that it was because of poverty and those who should speak up to challenge their weird thesis bought into the lie, notwithstanding the fact that most of their victims were usually Muslims. Yeah. Perhaps among those who turned deaf ears to the antics of Boko Haram at the beginning were Muslims who shared some of their resentment towards elements of Western civilization. But as in the prophetic words of the writer James Baldwin, the fire next time we consume even the air. Are you blaming northern leaders keeping quiet started?
If you reflect back to those periods, you hear people saying negotiate with Boko Haram, dialogue with them, all kinds of things, including people who are in government today. But is that what they are saying today?
Tell me more.
I don't know. I mean,
what are they saying today?
I don't know. I've already told you, including if you do rudimentary research as to what many of these prominent people in government today, especially when you know, were saying about Boko Haram 2014, you'll discover, you'll be shocked.
Conspiracy against Jonathan then?
I don't think it has. To be fair, I don't think it's a conspiracy. I think it's either naivety or ignorance on their part. Thinking that, I mean, this thing will whistle away, this is our politics and all that. Not understanding the nature of Boko Haram and now we can see the consequences of all those things.
At a time of serious economic crisis, everybody is singing the song of diversification, even when we are still trapped in the idea of luggage economy.
Yeah.
You remember this?
I do. I lectured in 2016 at Platform.
Unfortunately, the only place that holds a promise to the future is one we have cynically neglected. We no longer invest in education, science, and technology. You are tired of the political class, right?
Yeah, I mean, aren't you? I think we get it wrong because by neglecting education, we are neglecting our future, as it were. I mean, if you look at the old economy and the new economy, let's even do simple. If you know the kind of efforts a man like Dangote makes, for instance, for all his wealth, and you see a man like Zuckerberg, just an idea. I mean, you get the point I'm making, and then he makes billions and billions and billions, and it's knowledge based. So I'm not condemning luggage economy because we still need it. But I'm telling you, what I'm saying is that, look, is the way the world is moving now. It's knowledge that we should seek if we want to develop at the rate at which we should.
And you spanked us by giving us examples. You said currently Singapore has a cabinet of 20.
Yeah.
The prime minister, 2 deputy prime ministers and 17 cabinet ministers. You started with a prime minister who attended University of Cambridge where he graduated with a first class.
Yeah.
You gave other examples.
Yeah.
Therefore, Buhari should not be our president. Segun Adeniyi, say it.
No, I can't say that.
Because the examples you gave here is that we need the best brains to run the state.
Yeah.
Is that not what you said here?
No, I did. But I mean, it's not about Buhari. It's about the people he surrounded himself with. It doesn't really matter. I mean, look at America, for instance. It doesn't matter who the leader is. But you can judge the leader by the kind of people is surrounded him or herself with. And that's what matters at the end of the day. Yeah, Buhari can come with his, he's a general, I mean, a retired general, but he has to bring a pool of talent. I mean, and Nigeria is, in terms of human capital, Nigeria is one of the, I mean, one of the blessed countries in the world because we have them in all fields of human endeavor. So you have talented people to pick from. The bane of our country really is that when our leaders want to pick ministers, aides, and all that, they don't go for the best.
The message is simple. Only a highly trained national leadership can carry the burden of development along enlightened lines. Yeah. Buhari should not come back in 2019. Say it.
No, I can't say it. You are saying it. So if Buhari doesn't come back, like you, who is going to come back? I mean, who is going to be president? So, because the issue now is, I remember the conversation in 2015 was anybody but Jonathan. That we don't want Jonathan, but see what we have ended up with. So the question as you can ask, okay, we don't want Buhari again, but we can now, if we don't structure the conversation, we can end up with something worse.
Why not join to structure that conversation?
I do that every day. That's what I'm doing.
Is Chidi Mogalu not a technocrat?
No, Chidi is competent. I mean, he will make a good president, no doubt. But can he get it under the current environment where you talk about zoning? I mean, let's be practical here.
Mm.
The belief, general belief, north, south, is that the next president of Nigeria will come from the north. Except we want to deceive ourselves. That's the. Because we have to discuss this issue in the context of the environment under which we operate.
Can't we change the environment?
Yeah, it's not going to be easy. I think we must change the environment, but it's not something that you can do overnight. Yeah, we need to restructure even the conversation, and until we do that, it will be difficult for a Megalu to emerge, especially in 2019. He's the kind of president I want. To make the point, he may end up getting my vote, but as a practical reporter who is being on the field, I don't imagine that Mogalu is going to win next year.
What about if the Obasanjos decided to back him? Is that not part of the environment?
That will hand him some votes, but I don't think that will make him to cross get him across the line.
So basically, Buhari is our next president.
I'm not come 2019. So. No. I'm not saying so. So what I'm saying is that right now, I've not seen the challenger.
Have you made your money from publishing the book Against the Run of Play?
I make little money.
You know the electronic copy?
Yeah, I know. But people still bought books. But even the electronic copy, people said they will not take the free copy.
Were you disappointed when you saw the free copies circulating online?
I think I've learned to take that in my strides, because I think the point is that as a journalist, as a reporter or a writer, you don't really write for money if you have passion for it. Money is just something that comes.
But you complained about piracy.
No, and I told you that it's not for me, but for people in the arts. Mm. They are killing people in Nollywood, people in music, and other is there, and writers. People like me. Thank God, I make some money from my books, and I also, people still buy these books. But it's not everybody that has that kind of because I get mail from people who say, yes, I got free copy, but I still insist I want to buy a book.
You continue to write, right?
Sure.
You've written how many books now? More than five?
Yes, I think there are five.
The last 100 days of Abacha is one.
Yeah.
Power, Politics and Death, a front row account of Nigeria under the late president is one.
Yeah.
And another one is coming out in June.
In July.
You will not be tired of writing.
Thank you very much. Amen to that.
As we round off this discussion, where do you see Nigeria in 10 years?
I hope that in 10 years' time, we'll have stabilized. Nigeria will have gotten rid of most of our security challenges and be in a position to move forward.
Do you know how I define your book?
No.
The conspiracy of the political class against the Nigerian state.
Why?
Is that not what we have here? Because you complain in all the discussions. Mm. It's not about ideology.
No.
It's about power.
Yeah.
Is that not a conspiracy against the people?
It has all, but it, I mean, it didn't start with 2015. It has always been like that. And maybe that's the narrative. I hope that within the next 10 years will change so that we can begin to pick leaders on the basis of ideas and ideals.
Thank you for writing the book Against the Run of Play.
Thank you very much for having me.
And Mr. Olusegun Adeniyi, thank you for featuring on State Affairs.
Thank you very much.
I've been discussing with the author of the book Against the Run of Play how an incumbent president was defeated in Nigeria. Segun Adeniyi is the chairman editorial board of ThisDay newspaper. I am Edmund Obilo.
You're listening to Bush Radio.
Bush Radio. Your real talk radio.